여러분 안녕하세요. 오늘은 저에게 굉장히 뜻깊은 날이 될 것 같습니다. 제가 평소 존경하는 조지 메쎈버그 교수님과 함께 여러분들이 궁금해하시는 많은 부분들에 대해서 이야기 나눌 수 있다는 점에 대해서 굉장히 영광으로 생각하고 있습니다. 자, 그러면은 바로 시작해 보도록 하겠습니다. So good morning, George. How's it going?
Perfect.
Perfect.
And to our audience, I say 안녕, 하세요.
That was nice. Great. So for today, I have asked musicians and engineers around the world what they would ask you if they had a chance to see you or meet you in person. So I came up with a bunch of questions. I have a list here, if you don't mind me asking.
I welcome these questions.
Okay.
You know that sometimes I won't be able to answer them as clearly as I should, so you'll help me a little bit with trying to make these answers as clear as possible.
Cool.
And we'll look from our audience for some feedback at some point.
Sure. We'll definitely do that.
You know, challenges to these
okay.
answers.
Cool.
I always get challenges.
Okay. So the first question I want to ask you to challenge you is about critical listening. What do you think about critical listening, and when you listen to music, what do you listen for?
I think that's a great question. And it speaks to, as you know, everything that we teach and live here at sound recording at McGill. Critical listening is being able to understand how to listen, maybe from three different spots, you know. How to listen with my brain, how to listen in my heart, how to listen in my guts. Guts is probably dance music or marching band music, I don't know. It's something that really hits you there. Heart is music of the heart. You know, I love Spanish language for love songs because it's a beautiful language for love songs. And we do a lot with the head. As you well know, we ask you to evaluate sounds from the standpoint of making the correct decision in how to manipulate them, how to bend them to your will, how to use EQ, how to use compression. Moving microphones around, the importance of finding a great mic position, the importance of walking into a room and understanding what's going on in that room. Have you been with Steve Albini?
No, I haven't.
So you walk around a studio with Steve Albini and he'll go whoop, whoop, to evaluate what's going on in the room.
Okay.
And I've learned a lot from Steve Albini. He's also a great poker player. Lots to learn. So critical listening to a room. You could walk into this room and know right away that there's a resonance at, where do we measure it? Like 300 hertz. You know, it's just rough room. So critical listening is paying attention to these different areas at the same time. And not necessarily addressing any one area so quickly that you can't listen to it from the heart and from the guts, and take that into consideration. Critical listening and critical evaluation, I think, is at the core of the practice, the core of the practitioner's knowledge.
Okay. So the second question I want to ask was, I grew up listening to some of your work, and I must say they sound very clean and precise. Perhaps, is this the direction you usually go for when you record and mix?
That's a really good question. I had early experiences when we were learning by ourselves, with nobody telling us what to do, and we were listening to commercial records. This is in the 60s. This is a long time ago. And we, my friends and I, would listen to records from Motown and from Sigma Studios in Philadelphia and R&B records of that time, saying, how do we get that sound? I also listened to a lot of Phil Ramone recordings that he made at A&R Recording, and God, they just blew me away with the clarity, the transparency, and a way that I could listen repeatedly to the same recording and always hear something new, something revealed. And so that was my model. In Los Angeles, it was Bones Howe, the producer, engineer, and in New York it was Phil Ramone. But the recordings that I made sounded like far different than that. They were shitty, to coin a term. I can't use that other term you told me, but it sounded really shitty. I mastered that shitty sound. I really had that shitty sound down pat. No problem. You want a shitty sound? I got one for you. But I found very quickly that you didn't have a lot of room to mix and to create a picture with just a shitty sound that you needed on your palette. You know, you have this palette of sounds that you can go for different kinds of space and timbral balance in the instrument. And I found that it gave me more room if I were at least able to record clean and put something down to storage clean and then f it up later, to coin a term, to compress it or to reamp it or to, as you have seen, turn on the Sans Amp to 11.
Right.
So it's not always clean, but having a resource there that's clean gives you the ability to play two or more sources and sounds against each other. And to me, it's a conversation. Or decorating a room. It's hanging a picture in blue along this wall and a little Picasso miniature on the piano. And the way these sounds are perceived is a lot like what you perceive in all of the arts, mm-hmm. and how things relate. So clean is a part of that. Mm-hmm. It's a hard question to answer.
Okay. How do you keep depth and soundstage in a recording?
That's a really good question too. Man, these are good questions. I think that the answer is just don't screw it up, that you can start with depth and detail. If you have great signal path and you have really good converters in the digital world, clean path in the analog world, that you can make little sounds, you can give little sounds a place in your soundstage at the same time as big sounds. So recording and mixing for depth and detail is not so hard. You know, like anything else, it takes practice, and you have to learn what the conversation is in the soundscape. But past that, you have to just not trash it. And unfortunately, for many years, for 20 years, we've had MP3s with a dramatically reduced ability to resolve big sounds and little sounds in the same space. So we couldn't do that. You know, if we made a recording for great depth, for something on vinyl or something on very high resolution digital, and then do an MP3 of it, a lot of that goes away. It certainly doesn't have the same resonance as you would hope.
So people always talk about the great recordings you have made. But I want to ask you, what's your least favorite record that you made?
Well, there are a lot of them.
Okay.
And that's a really cool question, and it's one that I think most producer engineers don't want to face, that they've done recordings that are out there that are available that really suck. And I think my least favorite work were some of the things that I did in Nashville 10 years ago or so, where there was the Nashville system kind of rushing through a setup and getting as many tunes recorded as possible, which is the old Nashville style. They used to record a whole record in 3 hours. And that's still kind of in the accountant's mind, that we should be doing a record in 3 hours, not spending all these weeks in the studio or years in the studio. And some of the stuff we did was just not musical. It wasn't art. The songs were not hard fought. You know, somebody didn't, when trying to think of a great example. I think it's from maybe Lillian Hellman talking about a screenplay to someone. And maybe it was Fitzgerald, F. Scott Fitzgerald, and he's writing a screenplay of one of Lillian Hellman's works. And she can't say write well, and she can't say, she wouldn't say write good, but she said, write hard, Mr. Fitzgerald, write hard. And I miss that in modern work to a great extent, and to a great extent in Nashville. I mean, there are a couple writers that are great. Steve Earle is unbelievably talented and precise and understands how the language works. We were talking about how a really bad record can happen, really, in fact, because my least favorite records weren't because somebody went and said, I got a great idea, let's do a shitty record this time. But, you know, that, but let's really make it shitty. What do we do to make it really shitty? How would we do that? Because you always go in saying, oh, this one's going to be great. This is a home run, babe. You know, you always say that. And then what comes out is a stinking piece of shit. You learn from that. And you learn that some of the mistakes you make along the way are fixable. Starts with better songs. Starts with better writing. For me, it was about live performance. It was about a band and a singer performing at the same time so that you could really arrive at all the things that we knew from the old days were important, like finding the right key for the vocalist, mm-hmm. not too high, not too low, finding the right tempo so the vocalist could fit lyrics in, not band comes in, does a track, vocalist comes in 2 weeks later, you know, we're going to fix everything in Pro Tools. We've learned that doesn't work. But a lot of it has to do with recording live and walking out with a record. Having a record, walking out with something that you don't have to go crazy fixing. You know, it's already 99% there. It should be.
Yeah.
And that's what we've learned from practitioners in what I'll call the early days is make it sound right from the beginning. So maybe we're getting back to that.
So it was a little harsh for me to, I wasn't actually thinking that you were going to answer that question. So glad you did about least favorite records. What about your favorite records?
Well, one of my favorite records is Jennifer Warren's famous Blue Raincoat. Hmm. And I owned and ran a studio called The Complex in Los Angeles. And she did all the recording and most of the recording and all the mixing there. And I came in to the picture more as a friend of Jennifer Warren's. Linda Ronstadt and I were working together on another project down the hall. And we just heard this great music that she was working on. It was the songs of Leonard Cohen. And she picked, I forget, 12 songs at that point. And it was great. It was a great rhythm section. It was inspired. She asked a lot out of the rhythm section. And then I went on vacation on a raft trip down the Grand Canyon with Alan Sides and John Patoker and Judy, I forgot her name, but she, a lot of people that we just had a great experience. Alan Sides and I sat on the front of a pontoon boat going down the river, going through the Grand Canyon and talked about recording for 3 days, day and night. People thought we were nuts. And we spent at least a day just talking about Phil Ramone recordings. And I came back, and all I wanted to do was long reverb. So everything I did had a 7-second reverb because that's I came out of the Grand Canyon. I had to sound like the Grand Canyon, or what was I doing with my life? And so I mixed a couple of tunes. I mixed Manhattan, which had Stevie Ray Vaughan on it. It was remixed later, but I found the mix. Bird on a Wire, Famous Blue Raincoat, and I think one or two others. But Bird on a Wire is a reference mix for my life because it had, even though it's almost 35, 40 years ago, it had those things that we were talking about. It had depth and detail and drama. And it was a story in creating that space. I mean, yeah, it was an artificial space, but the instruments had a conversation and I rearranged things and Vinnie Caliuta was the drummer, and when I heard the mix, it was just a little tiny tom-tom, and I turned the floor tom up to 11 and put this long reverb on it, famously, turned the drums on, and I rearranged the song. And so that, and Jenny let me do it, and she had some great ideas. But that's one of my favorites. The Aaron Neville record that Linda Ronstadt and I did in 1987, I think, called Warm My Heart, Warm Your Heart. Warm Your Heart was a great record and launched his solo career. I love the first trio record, Dolly Parton, Linda Ronstadt, Emmy Lou Harris, is still a beautiful record. And I produced that. I worked very hard on it. And I'm very proud of it. It's being re-released this September, Trio 1 and Trio 2. And it was very difficult to get the girls' schedules together, and I think I did a pretty good job on it. Mm. So that's another one of my favorites. And there are others.
So I want to change some gears a bit and talk about technical stuff. Do you use EQ when you're recording?
You know, what's often asked is, do you always use EQ or do you never use EQ? And my answer, my standard answer is, I don't always do anything and I don't never do anything. I never, never do anything, and if you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. If it's the right thing at the right time, I'll do it. Yes, I'll use EQ in recording. A lot of the microphones that we use are already profoundly colored, like the Sennheiser 902. It has a huge smiley phase built into it, so that's EQ. Mm-hmm. I will avoid using high and low cut filters unless I'm really sure. And so I'll use a high pass filter for a vocal to get rid of pops, because I've come to a point in my life that where I don't like pops anymore. I used to like pops. Mm-hmm. I use EQ when it's appropriate. I'll occasionally use analog EQ. I'll occasionally use digital EQ in recording, but I will try for the most part to just concentrate on what makes a great sound for the band. That's the key thing for me in a session is, it's my job to blow the band away. When they put the earphones on, they gotta say, man, that sounds great. I can hear myself, I can hear everybody else. That sounds just great. Yeah. That's my job in recording, whatever else I do. I've come to the point where we have good enough A to D converters and good enough storage that I'll not use compression in recording, except in an extraordinary case where I really want this one sound and I'm sure of it. The reason is that where EQ is reversible, you know, that you'll be hard-pressed to find an EQ that you record with that you can't reverse later down the road. You haven't chosen the right frequency, or you've boosted something, and because you can't monitor one frequency in this crappy room, and you realize later on you have to reverse that. That's doable. You can't reverse dynamics. You can't reverse expansion. You can't reverse compression effectively. I mean, there are ways around this. I'm not going to say you never can reverse it, but it's hard. Hmm. Compress something and then down the road to expand it. So I'll generally do compression for a vocalist. I'll do compression for certain instruments in a track. But it's more to support the vocalist. It's not because I like the sound. It's that I'll get a better performance if the vocalist really can hear him or herself in context of everything else they're hearing through this narrow channel of headphone monitoring in a rock and roll recording studio. The better the performance, Chet Atkins said something like this, was, it's amazing how much better a record sounds as it goes up the charts. You know, a good recording has more to do with connecting with someone's heart, with the spirit of what you're trying to say in the song.
Okay. So talking about compression, we have to talk about MDW-DRC2, because I thought it was a big secret for everybody, but I guess everyone in the world knows about it, and they're just wondering, when is it coming out?
Well, I used to tour Europe, and while I was working on DRC1, and I had a kind of cool display, and it was designed only to work on TDM, Pro Tools TDM, the 56K DSPs. It was handcrafted, you know, the assembly language programming on a DSP chip. So it was quite a job. Bringing it up to date, the MDW DRC2 had to be coded in a different way. Had to be coded so it was equal performance in native and DSP, or HDX. So we finally have done that. Mm-hmm. I'm happy to report that we have out in full beta the expensive version of MDW DRC2 AAX. And that is now available in beta for people that would like to evaluate. It sounds really good. It's very flexible. It is my go-to compressor, and a number of my colleagues, it's their go-to compressor. Mm-hmm. But it's not for everybody. And as I said, unfortunately, right now it's very expensive because we'd like to start at the top of the market. We'd like to start with film sound mixers and dubbing mixers and producers that really want this product. And then a simpler product is down the road. Mm. But okay. No, it's out after all of these years. I started showing it in 2007, so we're almost 10 years of people seeing DRC, DRC.
Okay.
And we like the algorithm so much that the new version of GML Dynamics, we can't build 8900s and 2030s. We can't build that Dynamics processor because it's just too expensive. You know, we had to withdraw our product from the market and decide where we wanted to go. So we're back mm-hmm. out with mic pre's, EQs, and a channel strip, 2032, as you know. And we think that they're the right products for getting back into the orbit of our manufacturing again. Mm-hmm. For the dynamic range controllers, what I want to do is to do the control circuit, the processing in the control circuit with DSP, mm-hmm. very fast DSP, so the latency mm-hmm. to a VCA will be very short. Mm-hmm. But it will be a digitally controlled analog box, and we're going to call it the 2161. And it is a digital dynamic range controller, but the path is analog. Huh. So we'll have the dynamic range of analog and the precision of a DSP processor. Now, the old GML Dynamics had what was basically an analog computer. All those little circuit boards were an analog computer. And it was always executed with the thought that all these building blocks could be as easily done in DSP when DSP got fast enough. And I'm going back to when we first did it in the late 70s, and my first processor was a 6502, which also powered the first Apple II. I mean, I couldn't do any DSP on that. And the first DSP chip we had was the 56K. It was 10 MIPS. You know, I couldn't do anything on that. But finally, digital processing came up to the point where we could do the sophisticated processing that we needed to do for a DRC2. And here's where the processing, very quickly, here's the difficulty is, it's all about staying in the log domain. And going to and from the log domain is very expensive in the digital world. Mm-hmm. But that's what took the time, mm-hmm. and that's why we were waiting for a more powerful chip.
Okay. So most of my followers, my blog, are home recording musicians, engineers, and they often struggle with their room acoustics. And they want to know if there's any kind of trick where it can overcome your terrible room acoustics.
So my advice to a new practitioner is invariably to get a playback chain that's reasonable cost and that is high enough quality so that you can really hear the difference between recorded productions and even if you're listening to CDs. So my advice, I'm afraid, is to, if you don't have a lot of money and you don't want to take the time to make an adjustment in your room, whatever that requires, absorption or draperies or a big couch is always a good idea for low frequencies. And if you don't want to do that, get a good pair of headphones that you like and a good D to A converter. Mm-hmm. Good D to A converter, good headphones, is a good entry into critical listening, personal listening. Mm. You want to have a pretty good DAW, it would be useful to have it run 96K because we really want professional recording to happen at 96.24 and above. So I would advise that as a starting point. It's not for every situation, because a lot of times when you want to work with a musician or with a vocalist, you have to have speakers so you can share the experience. But at that point, you understand what it should sound like. You understand what effect your room has when you take your earbuds out and you listen to speakers. You say, oh, I didn't hear that before. You know how dramatic that can be. Mm-hmm. And you listen to good, and then you listen to flawed, and you hear what the problems are, and you hear what you have to do. But it's not easy, and you have to do it. We have to rebuild this room this fall so that it can have quality acoustics. And the recordist in a bedroom or in a garage, as far as recording, you know, you can do a lot with crappy ambiences, but as far as critical listening, you really need a clear path to what you've got to start with.